Hello all. So welcome to Dr. Ankit Pharmacology series. So now we will be starting with rapid MCQ revision series of central nervous system. Now the first topic we will be discussing among central nervous system are the drugs which are sedative and hypnotics. Okay. So remember, sedative and hypnotic drugs, they are of various types. We will discuss about the first drug, that will be barbiturates and benzodiazepines. Barbiturate and benzodiazepine, they will be acting on GABA A chloride channel. Then we will have melatonins, second last opioids, and lastly alcohols. So this is the complete list of the drugs we have among sedative and hypnotic. So let's start with the first one, that is barbiturates and benzodiazepines together. Okay, barbiturates and benzodiazepines. So if you talk about how barbiturates and benzodiazepines act, remember barbiturate and benzodiazepine, they open GABA A chloride channel which is present on a nerve. When this GABA A chloride channel opens, remember the chloride ion goes inside the neuron, there is chloride influx, and remember when negative charge moves inside the neuron becomes hyperpolarized and the neuron becomes suppressed. Because of suppression of neuron, they will produce sedation and hypnosis. Now at this channel, as you can see, this GABA A chloride channel, it is just like a rose. It has 5 subunits, that is alpha, beta and gamma, 2 alpha, 2 beta and 1 gamma. So it is having pentameric rosette like shape. Now where do benzodiazepines act? Remember, benzodiazepines, they act on alpha gamma subunit. Okay, they will act on alpha gamma subunit and they will open this GABA A chloride channel. While if you talk about barbiturate, barbiturate will act on multiple sites. Okay, so benzodiazepines, they act on alpha gamma subunit. So benzodiazepine, remember, they are agonist at alpha gamma subunit of GABA A chloride channel, they are agonist. There is a drug known as flumazenil, which is a competitive antagonist. It is antidote for benzodiazepine poisoning. And lastly, we have beta carbolin, which is also known as DMCM. It is an inverse agonist. It is not used. Okay, it is an inverse agonist. So let's see what is the difference between barbiturates and benzodiazepines we have. Now remember, if you think about barbiturate, see about barbiturate, they act on multiple allosteric sites. They act on multiple sites. While benzodiazepine, they act on alpha gamma subunit only. Now just focus on benzodiazepine. So benzodiazepine, they will only act on alpha gamma subunit and they will not open the channel directly. They will increase the binding of GABA. GABA is an inhibitory neurotransmitter. Hence benzodiazepines, they are known as GABA facilitatory because they increase binding of GABA. That is why they will increase the frequency of opening. Hence, they are known as GABA facilitatory. But if you think about, learn about barbiturate, barbiturate in low dose, they are GABA facilitatory. They will increase the frequency. But in higher dose, barbiturate, they becomes GABA mimetic. GABA mimetic means they themselves can open this channel. And in still higher dose, they will act on other channels as well. They will inhibit sodium, potassium, calcium channel. They also inhibit glutamate release. So that is why barbiturates are more of a non-specific drug. They are very dangerous drug. Their poisoning is very dangerous. So if you talk about the difference between barbiturate and benzodiazepines pharmacokinetic, barbiturate, they are narrow therapeutic index drug. That means they have low safety margin. Therapeutic index means safety margin. That is why they require monitoring. That is TDM, therapeutic drug monitoring. They are enzyme inducer. They are highly abusive and there is no antidote if their poisoning occur. But if you talk about benzodiazepines, they do not require any monitoring. They are safe drug. They are not enzyme inducer. They have low abusive potential. And we have a specific antidote for benzodiazepine poisoning. So try to remember a mnemonic, NEHA, with barbiturates. Now, if you talk about barbiturate poisoning, the symptoms of barbiturate poisonings are the patient will be flabby because there will be decrease in muscle tone, comatose. The patient will be suffering from hypotension and bullous eruptions will be on the skin. Now, there is no specific treatment of barbiturate poisoning. Now, remember, barbiturates are acidic drug. Hence, we will do forced alkaline diuresis. We will also do hemodialysis. A non-specific antidote can be given, which can be picrotoxin. The cause of death in barbiturate poisoning is respiratory depression. Hence, we give a class of a drug known as analeptics. Analeptics are respiratory stimulant. The drugs are bimegride and doxapram. Okay, now if you talk about benzodiazepine poisoning, we have a specific antidote in benzodiazepine poisoning, that is flumazenil. So flumazenil was a competitive blocker of alpha gamma subunit of GABA A chloride channel. Its half-life is 30 minutes, it acts for 30 minutes. Hence, it is given as a repetitive intravenous injection. This flumazenil is given as an antidote for benzodiazepine and atypical benzodiazepine poisoning. There is no role of flumazenil in barbiturate and opioid poisoning. Okay. Now let's talk about barbiturate as a drug. Remember, barbiturate, they are synthesized from urea plus malonic acid. Now their name either end with the word on or al. So they are short acting, ultra short, short and long acting. Among ultra short, we have thiopental or thiopentone, methoxetone or methoxetal. Similarly, we have long acting phenobarbital and mifobarbital. Now, why thiopentone and methoxetone are very short acting? Because when they are given intravenously, they rapidly get deposited in fats. This process is known as redistribution. So their action is terminated by a process known as redistribution. They are highly lipid soluble. They will rapidly deposit in fats. Now, the long acting drug we have is phenobarbital, a very important drug. Now, phenobarbital is such a long acting, so that is why it is used for prevention of seizures. Hence, it is used as an anti-epileptic drug. Now, phenobarbital is also an enzyme inducer. It induces UDP-GT enzyme in liver. Because of this reason, it is a drug of choice for neonatal jaundice, where the level of UDP-GT is very low. They are not able to conjugate bilirubin. Hence, phenobarbital is a drug of choice for neonatal jaundice known as Crigler-Nazar syndrome type 2 and Gilbert syndrome. Now, phenobarbital, its prodrug is primidone. It is an enzyme inducer. Now, how it is removed? 75% or 3/4 of phenobarbital is metabolized in liver and removed out in urine, and 1/4 is excreted unchanged without metabolism. Now, the main side effect of phenobarbital, it sometimes causes opposite effect. It may cause paradoxical seizure. It itself can cause seizure, and it can increase excessive movement in children, hyperkinesia in children. Okay. Now, if you talk about barbiturate, remember barbiturates are contraindicated in porphyria, while benzodiazepines and opioids can be given in porphyria. Okay. So, the drugs which are contraindicated in porphyria, phenobarbital, thiopentone, they are contraindicated. So, the mnemonic of the drugs are severe porphyria. Okay. Now, if you talk about benzodiazepine, they will end with the word AM, AM. Now, they are long acting. Why they are long acting? First, they will go very slow metabolism in the liver, very slow metabolism by CYP3A4, which is phase 1 metabolism. And then it undergoes very rapid phase 2 metabolism by glucuronide conjugation. Okay. While short acting drug, they don't undergo slow phase 1 CYP3A4 metabolism. They directly undergo direct glucuronide conjugation, which is phase 2. That is why these short acting drugs, which are not undergoing phase 1 metabolism, are absolutely safe in liver failure. So the benzodiazepines, which are short acting, are safe in liver failure. The drugs are total. Temazepam, oxazepam, triazolam, escitalopram and lorazepam. These benzodiazepines are safe in liver failure. Rest all other benzodiazepines are long acting drug. They all undergo phase 1 metabolism and they form active metabolite. Okay. Now, overall shortest acting is midazolam in them because its phase 1 metabolism is very fast. And this midazolam, remember, this midazolam causes maximum respiratory depression. It produces sudden effect. Okay. Now, if you talk about common side effect of benzodiazepine, they produce sedation. They cause memory loss. Entrograde, that means future incidents will be lost, will be unremembered. And it may cause retrograde amnesia or past memory loss. Because of this reason, a person will start taking repetitive self-medication because the person will forget to take benzodiazepine, that he or she has taken a benzodiazepine, which can lead to repetitive self-medication known as automatism. Now, if you talk about specific side effect of benzodiazepine, remember flunitrazepam is known as Rohypnol drug. It is a colorless, odorless and tasteless benzodiazepine. It is used as a day trip drug. Okay, it's a banned drug. Midazolam causes maximum respiratory depression, and midazolam should not be combined with CYP inhibitor like ritonavir. Triazolam causes psychosis, flurazepam causes nightmares, diazepam dilates coronary artery, and midazolam constricts cerebral arteries. Okay, now if you talk about atypical benzodiazepine, now how they are different from benzodiazepine, normal benzodiazepine. Now remember, atypical benzodiazepines are also known as Z compounds. They all start with the word Z. Now, normal benzodiazepine, they block alpha and gamma subunit, and alpha subunit is divided into two, alpha 1 and alpha 2. Now, alpha 1 opening causes sedation and sleep. Alpha 2 opening causes anti-epileptic and muscle relaxant effect. Now, atypical benzodiazepine, they only act on alpha 1 subunit, while normal benzodiazepine, they act on both alpha 1 and alpha 2. That is why atypical benzodiazepine, they only produce sedation and sleep. They are only used for the treatment of insomnia. Okay. And hence, they are not acting on alpha 2 receptor. Alpha 2 receptor, they are not acting. Because of this reason, atypical benzodiazepine, they don't have any muscle relaxant or anti-epileptic effect. Okay. They are addictive, yes, and their antidote is also flumazenil. So the drugs are zopiclone, zolpidem and zaleplon. They are the drug of choice for insomnia. Now they are more preferred over benzodiazepine, normal benzodiazepine or insomnia, because they cause less sleep cycle distortion and they don't cause much of a memory loss and hangover in the next day. Okay. Now if you talk about certain other drug for insomnia, we have melatonin congener. The first drug is remeltion, which act on MT1 and MT2 receptors of melatonin. It is used in SEZ, shift worker, elderly and jet lag patient. And it is an oral drug with 2% bioavailability, half-life is 2 hours, metabolism is CYP182. It is a non-addictive. Remember, melatonins are the only sedative and hypnotic drugs which are non-addictive. Okay? They don't cause any memory loss, they don't cause any sleep cycle distortion, but they are less effective. We have agomelatine, which is also a 5-HT2C antagonist. It is given for insomnia with depression. Tesimeltion is given to maintain sleep-wake cycle in blind people, circadian rhythm in blind people. Okay, so this is about barbiturate and benzodiazepine. Let's solve the questions of certain barbiturates and benzodiazepine with melatonin also. Okay, so which of the following statements are true regarding benzodiazepine? Benzodiazepines are GABA agonists. It's absolutely true. We have already discussed they are GABA A chloride channel agonist. They open GABA A chloride channel by acting at which site? Alpha gamma subunit. Now, diazepam is short acting benzodiazepine. Now, answer is absolutely false. Remember, diazepam is long acting benzodiazepine. Short acting benzodiazepine, I have already told you the mnemonic total. That is temazepam, oxazepam, triazolam, estazolam, and lorazepam. And among them, you can add midazolam also. So these are short acting. Okay. Diazepam causes less respiratory depression with midazolam. It's absolutely false. We have written that midazolam causes maximum respiratory depression. It produces sudden effect, midazolam. While if you write about diazepam, diazepam produces effect very subtly, very subtle effect. Okay. Nitrazepam is metabolized in liver. True. We have already discussed. All they are metabolized in liver. Diazepam has higher abuse potential than midazolam. Again, it's a false statement. Midazolam suddenly produces effect, and any drug which produces sudden effect has more abusive potential because it will lead to sudden addiction. If a drug is subtly producing effect, it will not be addictive. So if you talk about the true statement, are that benzodiazepine, they act as a GABA agonist. It's absolutely true. Okay. Diazepam causes less, diazepam, nitrazepam is metabolized in liver. It's absolutely true. Okay. Absolutely true. And only these two statements are absolutely true. Rest all statements are false. Now, which of the following best describes the mechanism of action of benzodiazepine? It activates GABA B receptor in the spinal cord. Now, it's a false statement. Remember, they activate GABA A receptor. Okay, they mainly act on GABA A receptor, not in spinal cord, rather in brain mainly. Okay, it blocks glutamate receptor in neuronal pathway. False. Now, it increases the frequency of opening of chloride ion channel that are coupled to GABA A receptor. Now, this is a true statement. So, the answer for this question becomes C. Okay? True statement. They are GABA, directly acting GABA receptor agonist in CNS. Yes, it is true. But if you talk about, the best statement, we have is C. Okay? Because here, the type of GABA A, GABA receptor is not mentioned. They specifically act on GABA A receptor. Remember, GABA, apart from GABA A, there are GABA B and GABA C receptors as well. Now, which of the benzodiazepine can be safely given in people with liver disease? So we have already written those drug. That was Total. Okay, Total. So the answer out here you can find is lorazepam, oxazepam, triazolam. True. So it was triazolam, oxazepam. So these benzodiazepines are safe in liver failure. Temazepam, eschazolam, and lastly lorazepam. So these benzodiazepines are safe in liver failure. So which is not given in the answer, that is diazepam. Hence the diazepam is the exception. So the answer is D. So the answer for this question is D, that is diazepam. Okay, diazepam is the answer. Now which of the following benzodiazepine is a benzodiazepine antagonist? So try to recall the antidote for benzodiazepine poisoning. We have already discussed it was flumazenil. So flumazenil was the antidote for benzodiazepine poisoning. Benzodiazepine, they are alpha gamma subunit of GABA A chloride channel agonist, while flumazenil is an antagonist, competitive antagonist. Okay, the shortest acting benzodiazepine overall is midazolam. Midazolam is the shortest acting benzodiazepine. Now even we have a new benzodiazepine which is even shorter acting than, overall the shortest acting even than midazolam is remimazolam. Remimazolam is even shorter acting than midazolam. Now which of the following drug is not metabolized in liver? So the answer was Total. And among Total, try to find the O word, that was oxazepam. Okay, oxazepam. The action of flumazenil on benzodiazepine receptor is, it is a competitive antagonist. So flumazenil is a competitive antagonist at alpha gamma subunit. Okay, so it's a competitive antagonist. Now flumazenil can reverse the respiratory depression caused by which of the following? That is midazolam, because midazolam is benzodiazepine. So flumazenil is an antidote for benzodiazepine poisoning. Okay. Now duration of action of flumazenil, I hope we have already discussed. Flumazenil act for 30 minutes. Okay. So the answer out here is 30 minutes. Now which of the following regarding flumazenil is true except, now it is a specific antagonist at benzodiazepine, it's absolutely true. It may be used for the treatment of barbiturate poisoning. Now this is a false statement. It is only given for benzodiazepine poisoning. Only benzodiazepine and atypical benzodiazepine poisoning, not barbiturate. It is given intravenously, true. It is given as an intravenous repetitive injection. It acts on the same site where GABA channel where benzodiazepine bind. Yes, true. Benzodiazepine is an agonist while flumazenil is an antagonist. Now, inverse agonist at benzodiazepine receptor or alpha gamma subunit, I have already told you that was beta carboline. So, beta carboline was inverse agonist. Okay. So, beta carboline was inverse agonist. Beta carboline is also known as DMCM. Okay. Now, which of the following drugs bind to GABA chloride channel complex? So, we have already discussed the drug was, if you think which of the following is a benzodiazepine, try to find. So, this was zolpidem. So, the answer is zolpidem. Zolpidem is an atypical benzodiazepine. Okay. Now, which of the following agent do not activate GABA A chloride channel receptor? Zopiclone, true, it's an atypical benzodiazepine. Benzodiazepine, true. Thiopentone, remember, is a barbiturate. So it's an atypical benzodiazepine. Benzodiazepine, barbiturate, they all act. What is promethazine? The answer out here is promethazine. Remember, promethazine is rather an antihistaminic drug. It acts on histaminic receptor. Now, which of the following drugs facilitate inhibitory action of GABA but lacks anticonvulsant and muscle relaxant property and has minimal effect on sleep architecture? So this is a classical definition of atypical benzodiazepine. And atypical benzodiazepine, they are also known as Z compound, because they only promote sleep. and they have no action as an anti-seizure action or anti-epileptic action of benzodiazepine or muscle relaxant property of benzodiazepine. Because they only act on alpha 1 subunit, they don't act on alpha subunit, alpha 2. So the answer Z compound here is zaleplon. Okay. So the answer out here is atypical benzodiazepine. A very potent and short acting benzodiazepine was given to the patient for hypnosis. But the drug causes psychiatric disturbances. Which of the following hypnotic is used? Now try to remember which benzodiazepine causes psychosis. The benzodiazepine which causes psychosis was triazolam. The side effect of triazolam was psychosis. And I have told you that triazolam is a part of total drug. It is a short acting drug which is safe in liver failure. So the answer is triazolam. Triazolam is a benzodiazepine which causes psychosis. A 40-year-old patient with liver dysfunction is scheduled for surgical process. Now what we have given? We have given lorazepam as a pre-anesthetic medication. And without concern of excessive depression, because the drugs is, remember that this lorazepam, it is safe in liver failure. So it's a part of total drug. It is safe in liver failure. The reason for safe in failure, liver failure is it does not undergo phase 1 CYP mediated oxidation. It does not undergo. It directly undergoes conjugation reaction in liver, which are very fast. They directly undergo conjugation reaction. Which conjugation? Glucuronide conjugation. And they are rapidly excreted out in urine. So the answer is B. Because they are conjugated directly in the liver. We have already discussed that diagram. Okay. Now, which of the following administration of barbiturate is contraindicated? We have already discussed that barbiturates are absolutely contraindicated in porphyria. Barbiturates are absolutely contraindicated in porphyria. So try to find the answer, acute intermittent porphyria. But remember, benzodiazepines can be given. Now, drug which can be safely given in porphyria, try to remember that mnemonic, severe porphyria. I'll show you that mnemonic again. So the drugs which are contraindicated in porphyria are severe porphyria, sulfonamide, ergot, valproate, erythromycin, ritonavir, estrogen. All these drugs are enzyme inducers and inhibitor. Phenobarbital, oxcarbazepine or carbamazepine, progesterone, phenytoin, rifampicin and anesthetic alcohols. Okay. So these drugs are contraindicated in porphyria. So keeping this thing in mind, phenobarbital, yes, true, it is contraindicated in porphyria. Okay. True, it is contraindicated. Okay. Ketamine, again, it is contraindicated. Valproate, contraindicated. Now, midazolam is a benzodiazepine. Benzodiazepines are safe in porphyria. And pethidine is an opioid. Remember, opioids are also safe in porphyria. Okay. So, the answer here is midazolam and pethidine. Midazolam and pethidine are the answer for this question number 18. Okay. Now, the effect of thiopentone on the CNS is short-lasting. We have already discussed thiopentone was an ultra-short-acting barbiturate. Why it was an ultra-short-acting? Because it was rapidly redistributed into fats. So, its action is terminated by a process known as redistribution. Okay. When we give IV, it rapidly gets deposited into fats. Now, which of the following statement regarding barbiturates is accurate? Okay. Benzodiazepine exhibit a steeper dose response curve as compared to barbiturate. Now, this is a false statement. If you draw a dose response curve, this is response, this is dose. The dose response curve of barbiturate is very steeper. It can suddenly lead to respiratory depression. But if you talk about benzodiazepine, the benzodiazepine is very flat. So benzodiazepine, they have flat DRC, dose response curve. While barbiturate, they have steep dose response curve, they can suddenly produce respiratory depression. That is why benzodiazepine, they are very dangerous drug. So it is opposite. So benzodiazepines, they have flat, barbiturate, they have steep. Barbiturate may increase the half-life of other drugs metabolized in the liver. Now this is a false. It will rather decrease half-life. Because barbiturates are rather enzyme inducer. If a drug is enzyme inducer, it will rather increase the degradation of the drug inside the body. Okay. Now, alkalinization of urine accelerates the metabolism elimination of phenobarbital. Now, this is a false statement. I've already told you that forced alkaline diuresis was the treatment of choice. So, this is a true statement. It is a treatment of choice for barbiturate poisoning. Now, respiratory depression caused by barbiturate overdose can be reversed by flumazenil. Remember, flumazenil is not the antidote for barbiturate. Flumazenil is rather the antidote for benzodiazepine. Okay. So, the only true statement is 3. That is C. Okay. So, the correct answer is C. Alkalinization of urine. Now, which of the following drug is contraindicated in acute intermittent porphyria? The answer out here is thiopentone. The answer out here is thiopentone. Thiopentone, remember, is a barbiturate. Barbiturates are contraindicated in porphyria. Both barbiturates and salicylates are minimally absorbed in stomach because both of these drugs, remember, are weakly acidic drug. Both of these drugs are weakly acidic drug. Okay. And weakly acidic drug, they become non-ionized in stomach. Non-ionized means lipid soluble in stomach. Because in stomach, the medium is already very acidic. Acidic drug in an acidic media becomes lipid soluble and they get absorbed. Although minimally absorbed, but remember only acidic drugs are absorbed in the stomach. So the answer out here is, that is C. Okay, so don't confuse with the word minimally, because all the drugs in stomach are minimally absorbed. The only drugs which are absorbed in the stomach is acidic drug. Basic drugs are not absorbed in the stomach, not even minimally. Okay, all are true about remeltion. Remeltion is MT1 and MT2 receptor agonist. The answer is absolutely true. Okay, so I'll show you the slide of remeltion. It's a melatonin congener. So it is MT1 and MT2 receptor agonist. It is used in insomnia in cases of shift worker, elderly and jet lag. It has just 2% oral bioavailability. Its half-life is 2 hours. It is metabolized by CYP1A2 and it is a non-addictive drug and it is used for insomnia. Okay. So it is act on MT1 and MT2 receptor. Yes, it's a substrate of CYP1A2. True. It has highly addiction. Remember, melatonins are non-addictive. Melatonins are non-addictive, while barbiturate, benzodiazepine, opioid, alcohol, all are addictive. They are used for the treatment of insomnia. Yes, true. The most effective non-habit forming sedative. So remember, the drug which is non-habit forming sedative is zolpidem. Zolpidem have least addictive potential among all of these. They are atypical benzodiazepine. Atypical benzodiazepines, they have least addictive potential. Okay. Flurazepam, they are normal benzodiazepine. They are highly addictive. Now, trazodone, remember, is a it is an antidepressant. It's an antidepressant. Remember, it is not given as a sedative drug. It is not a sedative. It is rather an antidepressant. Now, which of the following is true, not true about melatonin? Now, melatonin induces sleep. Yes, melatonin induces sleep in our body. It is used in the treatment of jet lag. Yes. It is secreted by pituitary. Now, this is a false statement. Remember, melatonin is rather secreted by a gland known as pineal gland. Okay. So, it is a pineal hormone. True. So, which is a false statement? C. Okay. All of the following are CNS stimulants except CNS stimulant. Remember, amphetamines, they are CNS stimulant. Cocaine also stimulate. Methylphenidate is also a stimulant drug because all increases sympathetic activity. Now, benzodiazepine, we already know it's a sedative and hypnotic drug. So, the answer is sedative and hypnotic drug. Okay. sedative and hypnotic drug. Now, let's continue with sedative and hypnotics, and now we will be discussing among the last topic of sedative and hypnotic, that is opioids, alcohol and drug abuse. Okay, now let's talk about first alcohol. Okay, now if you talk about alcohol, if nothing is mentioned, that alcohol means ethanol, which we drink for our party or for our own consumption. But overall alcohol, we have to discuss our three, that is ethanol, methanol and ethylene glycol. Now, all of these alcohols, they are metabolized in liver. First of all these three alcohols, they go into the liver and they get metabolized by an enzyme dehydrogenase. So the enzyme, first enzyme is alcohol dehydrogenase. Ethanol will be converted into acetaldehyde. Methanol will be converted into formaldehyde and ethylene glycol will be converted into glycolaldehyde. Now these aldehydes are converted into respective acid by an enzyme aldehyde dehydrogenase. Now ethanol finally gets converted into acetic acid and acetic acid gets eliminated out in urine. Methanol gets converted into formic acid. Now this formic acid is highly toxic to retina, which can lead to blindness. While ethylene glycol gets converted into glycolic and oxalic acid, which is neurotoxic and causes renal stones. So let's talk about first methanol. So if you talk about methanol, the main problem with methanol poisoning is due to accumulation of formic acid. Remember, formic acid is toxic to neurons. It is toxic to retina, it may cause permanent blindness, and it also damages the neurons in CNS, which may cause Parkinson's disease. Now, what is the treatment of methanol poisoning? The mnemonic is SHAFE. We give sodium bicarbonate to treat acidosis. Hemodialysis is the best treatment of methanol poisoning. The main antidote, the most specific antidote for methanol poisoning is fomepizole. That is the drug of choice. We also give folinic acid, which converts formic acid into CO2. And also to inhibit the metabolism of methanol, we give a competitor, that is ethanol. Okay, so this fomepizole, which is an alcohol dehydrogenase inhibitor, is the drug of choice for both methanol poisoning and ethylene glycol poisoning. Okay, but remember, so we have seen fomepizole is the inhibitor of alcohol dehydrogenase, and fomepizole is given in methanol and ethylene glycol poisoning. It is the drug of choice. Now there is a drug known as disulfiram. Disulfiram is an aldehyde dehydrogenase inhibitor. It is given in ethanol de-addiction. It is given to make a person de-addict of ethanol or alcohol. So let's talk about now alcohol. So if you talk about alcohol addiction, if a person with alcohol addiction, acute withdrawal comes to you, let's say with delirium tremens, we give intravenous benzodiazepine like diazepam, not written out here, which is the best drug, lorazepam, oxazepam. If the patient is having hallucination like Korsakoff psychosis, we give antipsychotic drug. Also, we give thiamine, vitamin B1. Now, the drug of choice for alcohol withdrawal is oral chlordiazepoxide. If oral chlordiazepoxide word is not given, then we will mark the answer diazepam. Now, if a person now has become totally de-addict, then we start the certain drugs to prevent relapse so that a person should not again start drinking. So we give anti-craving drugs and we give deterrent. Deterrent means which will create a fear if a person will drink. Among anti-craving, we have Nota, Naltrexone, Ondansetron, Topiramate and Acamprosate. Among them, Naltrexone and Acamprosate combination is given, they are approved. Now among deterrent, the drug of choice is disulfiram, which is also known as Entabuse. Disulfiram inhibit aldehyde dehydrogenase. Remember, deterrent disulfiram should not be given in those people who are actively drinking. It is only given to prevent relapse in those people who have already stopped drinking. Now, these are the certain drugs which can show disulfiram-like reaction, because remember, disulfiram should not be given in active drinkers. It could be dangerous. Patient can go into hypotension and shock. So these are the drugs like metronidazole, griseofulvin, chlorpropamide, carbamazepine, chlorfibrate, cephalosporin, and cancer drug like cyclophosphamide and procarbazine. Now remember, alcohol is absolutely contraindicated in pregnancy. It causes fetal alcohol syndrome. So what you have to remember, the face will be dysmorphic. There will be salt, short palpebral fissure, thin vermilion border, vermilion is upper lip, smooth philtrum, the junction between the nose and lips. Okay. Now if you talk about opioids, now let's talk about the last sedative hypnotic, that is opioids. Now opioids, they are obtained from opium, which is a resinous extract from the dried capsule of poppy plant. Now, opioids, they are contain very various chemicals. Some are phenanthrines, some are benzyl isoquinolines. Among phenanthrines, they are analgesic, they are very powerful pain relieving substance. Non-analgesics, we have papaverine and noscapine. Analgesics, we have morphine, codeine and thibane. Remember, these natural opioids are also known as opiates. So natural opioids are also known as opiates. Okay. Now, if you talk about how do opioids, they produce effect in the body. Opioid produce effect through opioid receptors. There are mainly three opioid receptors, that is mu, kappa and delta. Now, recently, a fourth opioid receptor, orphanin FQ, have also been cloned. Okay. Now, our body also produces endogenous opioid. On mu receptor, endomorphin act, kappa dynorphin and delta enkephalin. On orphanin FQ, nociceptin act. Now, what is the action of mu receptors? Mu receptor produces sacrum PG, S for sedation, A for analgesia or pain relief, constipation, respiratory depression is the cause of death, euphoria is cause of addiction, meiosis or pinpoint pupil, increased prolactin and they cause gallstones or biliary colic due to spasm of GIT sphincter. Now, this mu receptor, remember, is highly addictive receptor. But if you talk about kappa receptor, everything is same like mu, except instead of euphoria, you will write dysphoria. Hence, kappa receptor opioids are non-addictive and they call diuresis because of suppression of ADH hormone. Now, delta receptor mainly act in brain. That is why it has a name NK. NK means brain phalanx. So, it is responsible for emotions which are associated with pain, that is known as affective component of analgesia or supraspinal analgesia. We don't have any drug which act on delta receptor because delta receptor causes convulsions, affective behavior and reinforcement. Now, where morphine act? Morphine is a full agonist at mu receptor. So, morphine among them mainly act on which receptor? Mu. And that is why morphine produces euphoria. That is why morphine is an addictive drug. So, let's divide opioid into two. The first class of opioid which act on mu receptor. So, the drugs which are morphine-like, which act on mu receptors are natural, semi-synthetic and synthetic. Among natural, we have morphine and codeine. And this is the complete list of synthetic and semi-synthetic opioid. Now, these are the special property. The longest acting opioid is methadone. Shortest is remifentanil. Maximum plasma protein bound and most potent is sufentanil. Least potent is pethidine. The chronic renal failure contraindicated is pethidine again. Contraindicated in MI is pethidine and pentazocine. So, it's a short summary. For the complete concept that why they are contraindicated in renal failure, why they are contraindicated in MI, you have to see the complete videos. Contraindicated with MAO inhibitor is pethidine because it causes convulsions, tramadol because it causes serotonin syndrome. The reason is given in the complete set of the videos. Now, additional action on NMDA blocking properties, methadone, and additional anticholinergic action is of pethidine. So, it's a very short summary. Now, let's talk about the first drug, that is morphine. Morphine is a full agonist at mu receptor. Now, remember, morphine is given by all route except subarachnoid directly into CSF because it can cause respiratory depression and inhalational route. Remember, morphine is never given subarachnoid and inhalational. If these two routes are not given, then you will mark the answer sublingual. Okay, so morphine is not given by which route? Subarachnoid and inhalational. Now, how morphine is metabolized? CYP2D6. And remember, it forms two metabolites, 6-glucuronide and 3-glucuronide. 6 is the main active metabolite of morphine, which produces effect of morphine. But 3-glucuronide, remember, it produces convulsions or seizures due to morphine. So, it is formed during in high dose and mainly in children. Now, morphine, remember, also causes histamine release from mast cell. Hence, it may cause asthma. Now, uses of morphine. Morphine is an opioid and opioids are given for pain relief. And opioids are given in all type of pain except neuropathic pain and biliary pain, biliary colic pain. It is the drug of choice for MI because it has cardioprotective effect. It is also given in acute left ventricular failure or pulmonary edema. Now, morphine and opioids are absolutely contraindicated in head injury because they increase intracranial tension due to accumulation of CO2. Asthma is also a relative contraindication. Now, if you talk about opioid, they are highly addictive substance. Remember, in acute opioid poisoning, the patient will come to you with the symptom of sedation, pinpoint pupil, and death is due to respiratory depression. The drug of choice for acute opioid poisoning is intravenous naloxone. It's an inverse agonist. It will produce opposite symptom, except convulsion. It's an inverse agonist. Detoxification. Now, the drug of choice for de-addiction or the drug of choice for withdrawal is methadone or buprenorphine. Methadone is more preferred. Okay. And the drug of choice to prevent relapse is oral naltrexone. It is an antagonist. Okay. Now, why they are used in respective condition? You have to see the complete concept of drug de-addiction. Okay. So, complete concept, you have to see the videos. Now, there are certain opioids which are used in diarrhea. That is loperamide, diphenoxylate. Loperamide is a non-addictive opioid. It cannot cross enter into blood-brain barrier. Diphenoxylate is addictive. That is why we combine atropine with it. Other drugs, new opioids are given. Now, opioid itself can cause constipation. Hence, we give anti-opioid, opioid blocker. These are the drugs which are used for opioid-induced constipation. That is LV-MOPAN. MOPAN means mu opioid antagonist. While naloxone, methyl naltrexone and naloxicol, they block all mu, kappa and delta receptors. Okay. Now, these are mixed acting opioid. Apart from mu receptor, they act on other receptor. And remember, these opioids are non-addictive drug. So, the first opioid we have is kappa agonist and mu antagonist. Non-addictive opioid is pentazocine, nalfurafine, nalbuphine, nalorphine and butorphanol. Okay. Now, partial mu agonist and kappa antagonist, we have buprenorphine and dizocine. Dizocine is a very fast-acting intravenous opioid given as an analgesic. Then we have pure antagonist. All start with the word NAL, N-A-L, NAL, except NAL, nalorphine, wagera. Okay, so remember. Now, this is the complete summary of opioid. Opioid, they are highly addictive. The tolerance, they show rapid loss of effect because addictive substance, they show rapid loss of effect. The earliest sign to the earliest tolerance developed to euphoria. Tolerance do not develop to convulsion, constipation and constriction of pupil. So this is all about opioid and alcohol in nutshell. So let's start with now the drugs. Now dysphoria is caused by which opioid receptor? Dysphoria, remember, is caused by which opioid receptor? I have told you, kappa. Okay, so let's see that slide again. So, dysphoria is caused by which opioid receptor? We will write kappa. So, kappa instead of euphoria produces dysphoria. That is why kappa is a non-addictive opioid receptor. Okay. Now, the next question is true statement regarding. Now, the next statement is true statement regarding methadone are all except. So, let's talk about methadone now. Now, we know that methadone is the longest acting mu receptor opioid. Yes, it is the longest acting opioid. So, methadone overall is the longest acting opioid. Okay. It is rapidly absorbed from GIT and detected in plasma after 30 minutes. Now, it's true. Remember, when methadone is given orally, its action starts in 30 minutes. And when it is given IV, its action starts in 10 minutes. Okay. The primarily use of methadone is relief of chronic pain. Yes, opioids are given for pain relief. And it is also given, if you talk about use, it is given for pain relief like cancer pain. And it is also the drug of choice for opioid de-addiction or opioid withdrawal because of such a long-acting effect. Okay. Now, the onset of analgesia is 30 to 60 to 30 minutes after parenteral administration and 1 to 2 hours after oral administration. Now, this is a false statement. Remember, after parenteral administration, the action starts within 10 minutes. And after oral administration, the action starts within 30 minutes. So, the false statement is D, which we have already written out here. Okay. So, we have already written this statement out here. So, this is everything about methadone you must remember. Okay, a young man with a known heroin addict, heroin is diacetyl morphine, is brought to emergency with unconscious state. So can we say it's a classical case of acute morphine poisoning or acute opioid poisoning? Okay, so the drug of choice for acute opioid poisoning, the drug of choice is intravenous naloxone. Okay. Intravenous naloxone is the drug of choice for acute opioid poisoning. Okay. It blocks the receptor of mu, kappa and delta of opioid. It blocks all receptors. Which of the following opioid is contraindicated in renal failure? The only opioid which is contraindicated in renal failure is pethidine. Okay. The opioid which is contraindicated in renal failure is pethidine. Because in pethidine, in renal failure, there is a metabolite of pethidine which will accumulate. Pethidine accumulates in renal failure. And accumulation of pethidine causes a side effect known as seizures. Okay, so I'll show you that list again where we have discussed all opioids. Okay, so which opioid is contraindicated in renal failure? You can see that is pethidine. The longest methadone, shortest remifentanil, contraindicated in renal failure, pethidine, contraindicated in MIs, pethidine and pentazocine, contraindicated with MAO inhibitor is pethidine and tramadol. Okay, chalo. Now rave party drug is, now rave drug is known as, remember the drug which is known as rave drug is amphetamine. Amphetamines are known as rave drug. They are also known as ecstasy. They are also known as crystal meth. Okay, crystal meth. So the answer out here is amphetamine. Now all of the following are the adverse effect of naloxone in the treatment of opioid poisoning. Remember naloxone, remember causes. Naloxone produces opposite response. It is an inverse agonist. Opposite effect of opioid. Now remember opioids, they generally cause hypotension because of histamine release. Hence naloxone will cause hypertension because it is an inverse agonist. Inverse agonist produces opposite effect. Okay. Now opioids, remember they are used in the treatment of pulmonary edema. We have already discussed. They are used in the treatment of pulmonary edema. It may cause pulmonary edema as a side effect. Okay. Now opioids may produce convulsions or seizures. You will write that it will not produce seizures or convulsions. So this is an important because it will produce opposite response. The answer out here is it will not produce seizures. Okay. Now opioids, they produce bradycardia. This will produce tachycardia, which is a kind of arrhythmia. So it is seen, which is not seen is seizures. So naloxone does not produce seizures. Which of the following drug is used worldwide for maintenance of opioid dependence? The answer is methadone and buprenorphine. These are the two drugs which are approved for opioid dependence. Okay, that is methadone and buprenorphine. Best drug is methadone. Okay, true about epidural opioids are all except. Now remember, when opioids are given in spinal cord, they act on dorsal horn of substantia gelatinosa true, because it is the first pain relieving pathway where the first relay occurs. So here the substance P is released, which generally causes pain sensation. So this is the site of action of opioids in spinal cord, that is substantia gelatinosa. It may cause itching true, because they cause histamine release. They may cause histamine release. Okay, they may cause histamine release. The function of intestine is not affected, false. Remember, opioids, they cause constipation. They decrease bowel movements. That is why opioids are used in the treatment of diarrhea. Okay, they cause respiratory depression, true. Yes, it is the side effect of opioid. So the answer is C. The false statement is C. Okay, so C is the false statement. Now buprenorphine is partial mu agonist with kappa antagonist. This is the complete definition of buprenorphine. So try to find the answer. The answer out here is partial mu agonist you are getting. So answer is A. So this is written. So I'll show you that slide again. So if you talk about buprenorphine, if you see, we have already written buprenorphine as partial mu agonist and kappa antagonist. It's a type of mixed acting opioid. Okay. Now tolerance developed to all actions of opioid except There are three actions of opioid to which tolerance do not develop. One is convulsion, second is constipation, and lastly constriction of pupil. To these three effects of opioid, no tolerance develop. No tolerance develop. Constriction of pupil is also known as meiosis. Okay? Constriction of pupil is also known as meiosis. So the answer out here is meiosis. Okay? No tolerance. Now, an addict presents with increased sweating, lacrimation, diarrhea, yawning and rhinorrhea. Remember, these are the symptoms of opioid withdrawal. Okay? So the answer is heroin. Heroin is an opioid, we know. So I'll show you the symptoms of opioid withdrawal. So these are the symptoms of opioid withdrawal, like lacrimation, salivation, yawning, diarrhea, midriasis, or secretions are increased. While in opioid poisoning, all secretions are reduced. Okay? And there will be pinpoint pupil meiosis. In opioid withdrawal, there will be midriasis. Okay? Opioid tolerance earliest developed to euphoria, not developed to convulsion, constipation, and constriction of pupil. Okay? A newborn developed respiratory depression in a post-operative ward. It can result, respiratory depression is due to, it can result from due to, can we say that a person with opioid dies due to respiratory depression? Okay? Respiratory depression. Now, respiratory depression can cause all by except. The answer out here is strychnine. Opioid, remember, it's a sedative and hypnotic drug. It suppresses CNS. A person dies due to respiratory depression. Barbiturate and gelsinium are also sedative drug. They depress CNS. Now, remember, strychnine is rather a stimulant drug. Okay? It may cause stimulation in spinal cord because it inhibits glycine. Glycine is an inhibitory neurotransmitter, hence it may cause excitation. And it mainly acts not in the level of brain, it mainly acts in spinal cord. It mainly acts in spinal cord. So strychnine does not cause respiratory depression. Naltrexone is used in the following. Remember, naltrexone is a drug of choice to prevent relapse. Okay? Drug of choice to prevent relapse of opioid. That is oral naltrexone. But if you talk about IV naloxone was given for acute opioid poisoning. So remember the difference between these two. Naloxone is given for acute opioid poisoning, and naltrexone is given to prevent opioid relapse so that a person should not start taking opioid again. And naltrexone is an oral drug. Naloxone is an IV drug. Okay. All of the following can be used to treat heroin dependence. Heroin is an opioid, except. So if I'll show you that slide again of opioid de-addiction. So in acute opioid poisoning, we give IV naloxone. In detoxification, the drug of choice is methadone and buprenorphine. But to control acute withdrawal symptom, we give sympatholytic drug like clonidine and lofexidine. And to prevent relapse, we give naltrexone and nalmefene. Okay? So keeping this thing in mind, disulfiram, false. We have not written. Disulfiram is rather given in alcohol de-addiction. It is given in alcohol de-addiction. Buprenorphine, true. Clonidine and lofexidine are alpha 2 agonists, they are used. So the answer out here is disulfiram. Disulfiram is rather given in alcohol addiction. It is given for alcohol de-addiction, not opioid. Last three drugs are given in opioids. Now, which of the following drug is not an opioid agonist? So the drug which is not an opioid agonist is ketamine. Okay. So heroin is true, methadone is true, codeine is true. I have already shown you the list. Okay. Now, naltrexone is used to maintain abstinence following withdrawal of addict. It blocks which of the following features of use of opioid except. Now, this naltrexone we can write, it cannot reduce the craving for opioid. This is the drawback of naltrexone when we give naltrexone to prevent relapse. So naltrexone, remember, it cannot reduce craving for opioid. So naltrexone cannot reduce craving. cannot reduce craving for opioid. Okay, naltrexone. But remember, this naltrexone is also given in alcohol. This naltrexone, remember, it can reduce craving for alcohol. So where it will be a better drug, alcohol or opioid? Remember, it's a better drug in cases of alcohol. So naltrexone cannot reduce craving for opioid, but it can reduce craving for alcohol. Okay, now all of the following are true about opioids except naloxone is short acting. Let's write true. Okay, true, that is why it is given intravenously, very short acting for acute opioid poisoning. Naltrexone is given to lower the craving for alcohol. Yes, we have already just discussed. Nalmefene can be used for opioid poisoning. Yes, nalmefene is given. Now, nalmefene is shorter acting than naloxone. Now, this is a false statement. Overall, shortest acting drug is naloxone. Shortest and fastest acting drug is naloxone. That is why naloxone is given IV for acute opioid poisoning, because of fastest effect. Okay, that is why it is the drug of choice. So the false statement is nalmefene. Now, which of the following is least narcotic opioid or least addictive opioid? So I've already told you the least narcotic was or non-addictive opioid was papaverine. Okay, so papaverine is rather non-analgesic and non-addictive opioid. And there is another opioid which is non-addictive and non-analgesic, that was noscapine. So these are all opioids. So I'll show you that slide again. So we have already discussed. So these papaverine and noscapine are non-analgesic, and you will also write they are non-addictive and non-narcotic. Okay, so let's move forward. Which of the following symptoms may be seen in opioid withdrawal? Remember, in opioid withdrawal, all secretions of the body increases. Okay, all secretions of the body increases, like there will be diarrhea due to increase in bowel movement, more secretion. There will be lacrimation. There will be salivation. Now there will be yawning. With salivation, you can also write rhinorrhea. Okay, and remember, the last part is normally it causes midriasis. These symptoms become opposite in cases of opioid poisoning. In opioid poisoning, there is no diarrhea, there is constipation. There is dry eyes, dry mouth, dry nose. There is respiratory depression, not yawning. There is rather meiosis. So the answer out here, which of the following symptom is seen in opioid withdrawal? The answer is lacrimation. All secretions of the body are increased. So it is seen in opioid withdrawal. While all other symptoms 1 to 3, they are seen in opioid poisoning. Remember, poisoning and opioid withdrawal, they have opposite symptoms. Okay, now which of the following is used to maintain abstinence in alcohol dependence? So I've already told you the drug which is used to give abstinence in alcohol is naltrexone, true, and disulfiram. Okay, so naltrexone and disulfiram are used. Naltrexone is given as an anti-craving drug, and disulfiram is given as a deterrent drug. Okay, which of the following is ascribed to delta type of opioid receptors? So I'll show you that delta type of opioid receptors. So delta types of opioid receptor, if you think, I have already told you, it mainly acts on brain. It produces analgesia as an effective component. That means in brain, supraspinal analgesia, convulsions, affective behavior, and reinforcement. So you can write that which of the following is ascribed for delta. Remember, delta are mainly present in CNS. That is supraspinal level, above the spinal cord. Hence, it causes supraspinal analgesia, which is specific for delta type of opioid receptors. Now, morphine can be used in all of the following except, remember, the absolute contraindications of morphine is head injury, and second is asthma. Now, head injury is absolute, asthma is relative. Okay, so if both options are given, you will go by the answer head injury. Now, why it is contraindicated in head injury? Because morphine or opioids, they increase CO2 because of respiratory depression. And this CO2, remember, increases intracranial tension. And it may worsen the head injury. It will compress the brain. Why it is contraindicated in asthma? Because morphine causes histamine release. Histamine release itself can cause asthma. It will worsen asthma. So if both options are given, you will go by the option of head injury. Okay. So remember, if head injury is not given, then you will go by the answer asthma. Now, which of the following opioids have maximum plasma protein binding? I have already told you that was sufentanil. Sufentanil has maximum plasma protein binding. And it is also the most potent opioid. This pethidine was least potent. Okay. Now, naloxone is contraindicated in neonatal resuscitation in a mother if a mother is on methadone because it will precipitate opioid withdrawal. The person will suddenly go into opioid withdrawal, which can be very dangerous. So, among them, methadone is an opioid. Okay. Methadone is an opioid. Now, mu receptor is responsible for following effect. I've already told you the mnemonic Sacrum PG. S for sedation. A for analgesia. C for constipation. R for respiratory depression. U for euphoria. M for meiosis. P for increase in prolactin. And G for increase in gallstones or biliary colic. So these are the effect of mu receptors. So you can see from this option, meiosis is given. Okay. Meiosis is given. Remember, they don't cause bradycardia. They rather cause tachycardia. But it is not ascribed to mu receptor. They cause hypothermia due to vasodilatation, not hyperthermia. And they rather cause asthma, not bronchodilatation. So these are all opposite effects of opioid. Drug not used in analgesia in the patient of head injury. Remember, opioids are contraindicated. So opioids like morphines are contraindicated in patient of head injury because it may increase intracranial tension because of retention of CO2. True statement about desocine. Now remember, desocine is an synthetic mixed acting opioid. Now, what is the mechanism of action? Desocine is a partial mu agonist with kappa antagonist. Okay. Now, remember, it is a non-addictive opioid and it is given IV for pain relief, analgesic. Now, when you compare this with morphine, remember, it is faster than morphine. And it is equally potent. Equally potent means it will require same dose of morphine. And it is a non-addictive drug. So that is why desocine nowadays is more preferred drug over morphine. Okay. So let's solve this question keeping this thing in mind. It is slower acting than morphine. Now the false. It is rather a faster acting drug than morphine. It is less potent than morphine. False. Remember, it is equally potent than morphine. It acts by GABA receptor. Now false. Remember, it's an opioid receptor. It acts on which receptor? Partial mu agonist and kappa antagonist. It doesn't increase histamine release. Remember, false. It is a true statement. Remember, morphine causes histamine release, but desocine does not cause histamine release. It increases plasma catecholamine level. False. So the good thing about desocine, true statement is only D. Okay. Morphine can be administered by all of the following route except the answer is which is not given. Morphine is not given by subarachnoid route and inhalational route. And in earlier time, morphine was also not given sublingually, but now sublingual morphine can be given. Okay. So it is subarachnoid or inhalationally, and you are finding out here subarachnoid. Okay, subarachnoid. Now, established route of morphine includes Remember, morphine is not given subarachnoid and inhalationally by all other route it is given. So inhalational route is not given. Rest all other route morphine can be given. Okay, so which is not an established route, that is inhalational is not an established route. All are other established routes for the answer is B, C, D and E. Okay, now which of the following statement regarding naltrexone is true? Naltrexone. Okay, now naltrexone is an opioid agonist. False. It is rather an opioid antagonist. So it is an opioid antagonist. Now this is a true statement. So it's an opioid antagonist. Second, it is used in alcohol dependence. True. Remember, it is given for both alcohol dependence as well as opioid dependence. Okay, so second statement is also true. It is used to treat opioid dependence. True. Okay, now it is an respiratory stimulant. The answer is false. The respiratory stimulant is rather IV naloxone, inverse agonist. It is rather an respiratory stimulant. So the answer is B, C and D. Now which of the following opioids should not be given with MAO inhibitor? There are two opioids which should not be given with MAO inhibitor. One is pethidine. Okay, pethidine, and second is tramadol. Because pethidine with MAO inhibitors may cause seizures. And pethidine MAO inhibitor with tramadol will cause serotonin syndrome because of these side effect. So these two opioids should never be given with MAO inhibitors. So the answer out here you are finding out here is pethidine. Okay. The characteristic feature of opioid withdrawal is increase in secretions of the body, midriasis and yawning. Okay. So think rhinorrhea and lacrimation. Yes, there is increase in secretion. Seizures, no. Delirium tremens, no. Okay. Hallucination, false. So the answer out here is A. Okay. Drug of choice for controlling severe pain of cancer is opioids. Okay. And among them, you will mark the answer morphine. Okay. Morphine. Because codeine is also an opioid, but it is less potent analgesic. It has less potent analgesic, means it has less pain relieving substance property as compared to morphine. Okay, diclofenac and brufens are non-steroidal anti-inflammatory drug. So severe pain, remember, we always give opioids. In mild to moderate pain we give NSAID. In severe pain we give opioids. Which of the following statement is false about naltrexone? It is parenterally administered. False. Okay. Why? Because naltrexone is rather given orally. If you talk about parenterally, parenterally is given IV naloxone. So parenterally we give naloxone, not naltrexone. It is used to prevent relapse of heavy drinking or alcohol. True. It is long acting. True. It is hepatotoxic. True. So the answer is parenterally. In acute morphine poisoning, drug of choice is IV naloxone. Now the point is, you are not finding out here the word naloxone. So the drug of choice is IV naloxone. It is the drug of choice. But by default, as we are not finding any drug out here, you will go by the option naltrexone. Okay. But remember, the better answer is IV naloxone. Okay. Naltrexone is used in the poisoning of which following drug? That is opioid, that is heroin. It is given for opioid de-addiction. Regarding opioid induced seizures, let's say I have already told you that morphine may cause seizures mainly in children. It mainly causes seizures in children and in high dose. So opioids like morphine causes seizures mainly in children and in high dose. These are the two risk factors for opioid induced seizures. The risk factors for opioid induced seizures is children and high dose. Which of the following is contraindicated in acute myocardial infarction? Now remember, there are two opioids which are contraindicated in acute MI patient, that is pethidine and pentazocine. These two opioids are contraindicated in MI. because these opioids, they cause tachycardia. Tachycardia will increase the demand of the heart. It will worsen MI. Tachycardia will worsen MI. That is why we give morphine, because morphine causes bradycardia. Okay. So the go by the answer pentazocine, which is given out here. The most important feature of opioid analgesic in high oral or parenteral ratio is, the answer out here is, remember, the drug which have higher oral to parenteral activity is methadone. Okay, it has high oral to parenteral ratio. Remember, when we give methadone, when we give methadone orally, it produces action in 10 minutes. When it is given parenterally, it mainly produces action in 20 to 30 minutes. Okay. And its action lasts for 10 minutes. Its action lasts for 20 to 30 minutes. So somehow the ratio will come out to be 1:2. Now, action of opioid in man include all of the following except. Remember, the answer is mydriasis. Opioids, they rather produce miosis. Constriction of pupil, known as pinpoint pupil. Which of the following drug has more analgesic effect than morphine? The most potent or most powerful analgesic is fentanyl group. And among fentanyl, you will write sufentanyl. Okay, fentanyl is 1000 times more analgesic than morphine. Fentanyl is 100 times more potent analgesic than morphine. Sufentanyl is 1000 times. Then you will write diacetylmorphine. Diacetylmorphine is also known as heroin. Now remember, heroin is 10 times more potent analgesic than morphine. Okay. If you talk about least potent analgesic we have is pethidine. Now, pethidine is 1/10 time potent analgesic or pain reliever than morphine. So, most potent overall is sufentanyl. And you can find out here, the answer given is heroin. Remember, heroin is also known as diacetylmorphine. So, among them, you will find, go by the answer, heroin. Okay. Now, which of the following is not an opioid? Peptide. We have already discussed that endorphin, enkephalins are opioid. Epinephrine is not an opioid. Epinephrine is rather a sympathetic hormone, sympathetic nervous system hormone, catecholamine. Pure opioid antagonists are all of the following except. That is naloxone, true. Nalmefene, true. Naltrexone, true. It is not nalorphine. Okay. So all these drugs, A, B and D, are opioid antagonist. Nalorphine, you will write, it is kappa agonist with mu antagonist. While all other drug A, C and D, they are mu, kappa and delta antagonist. So that is why they are known as pure antagonist. I have already shown you the list. Okay. Endogenous opioid include enkephalin, endorphin, dynorphin. Yes, enkephalin act on delta, endorphin they mainly act on mu, dynorphin they act on kappa receptor. Hence it is all of the following. Which of the following opioid analgesia is suitable for hemodynamically unstable patient? Hemodynamically unstable patient, we generally give fentanyl. Okay, fentanyl. Now let's see why. Now fentanyl is an opioid which does not interfere with BP. Okay. Fentanyl does not interfere with BP. But if you talk about morphine, morphine causes hypotension. But if you talk about pethidine and pentazocine, these two drugs, they produce hypertension. So which group does not produce neither hypotension and hypotension, hyper and hypo? That is fentanyl group. So fentanyl is hemodynamically stable. So hemodynamically stable opioid is fentanyl group. Okay. Now what is tramadol? Tramadol is an opioid analgesic. Okay. Tramadol is an opioid analgesic. Opioid analgesic used in the treatment of cough is, we will write, that is codeine. Okay, codeine. So codeine, it is the most effective antitussive agent we have. Okay, codeine. Now true about naltrexone is, we know naltrexone act on opioid receptor. True, it is an antagonist at opioid receptor. It is used in treatment of opioid alcohol dependence. True, it does not, it can reduce craving in dependence of alcohol. True, it is an opioid agonist. Now this is a false statement, it is rather an antagonist. Now dextromethorphan is differs from codeine. Remember, codeine is an opioid. It's a natural opioid which act on mu receptor, and it act as an antitussive. It suppresses cough center. The side effect of codeine is, it is sedative, it produces constipation, and it is highly addictive. Now if you compare with dextromethorphan, dextromethorphan, remember, if you talk about dextromethorphan, dextromethorphan is rather an NMDA antagonist. It is also given as an antitussive for cough suppressant. Antitussives are cough suppressant. Side effect, none of the following. It is not sedative, non-constipation, no addiction is seen. So that is why dextromethorphan is more preferred over codeine now. Okay. So because of this reason, can we say the effect of codeine can be reversed by naloxone? The effect of codeine can be reversed by naloxone because naloxone blocks opioid receptor, and the effect of dextromethorphan cannot reverse by naloxone because naloxone act on opioid receptor, dextromethorphan rather act on NMDA receptors. Okay, so keep this thing in mind. Let's talk about 319. Dextromethorphan differs from codeine is, its antitussive action can be blocked by naloxone. Now false. Naloxone acts on opioid receptor, dextromethorphan acts on NMDA. It depresses mucociliary function. Now false. Remember, it is an antitussive. Antitussive drugs, they suppress cough center in brain. They suppress cough center in brain. They do not suppress mucociliary function in airway. Addiction in common, false. Remember, it's a non-addictive substance. It causes no constipation. Now this is a true statement. It is non-constipative, non-sedative and non-addictive, antitussive or cough suppressant drug. Okay, which suppresses cough center in the brain. Which of the following is 100 times more potent than morphine? We have already discussed that drug was fentanyl. Drugs that can be used for opioid de-addiction are clonidine. True. Okay, clonidine. True. Diazepam. True. Yes, to control seizures we can give. Methadone for de-addiction. So the answer is all of the following. Okay, site of action of opioid receptor is, remember, it acts on dorsal horn cells of substantia gelatinosa. Okay, so this is the site of opioid action. Opium is a derivative of which plant? That is Papaver somniferum plant, which is also known as poppy plant. Okay, so it is obtained from dried capsule of poppy plant. Most potent analgesic is, overall most potent opioid is sufentanil, 1000 times more potent. Fentanyl 100 times, remifentanil 10 times, L-fentanyl 10 to 240 times. But you don't have to remember, try to remember, most potent opioid is sufentanil. Morphine can be given by all route except, morphine should not be given by subarachnoid and inhalational route. Now, if these two routes are not given, mark the answer sublingually, because earlier morphine was not given sublingually, but nowadays it can be used. So the answer out here is sublingual. Okay, if subarachnoid and inhalational is not given, then you will go by the answer sublingual. Opioids differ from opiates is, remember, opiates are natural opioids. While opioids could be natural or synthetic, they could be natural or synthetic. So the answer out here is that opiates, that they are opiates are synthetic derivatives. Okay. Now, which of the following is naturally occurring opioid? There are three naturally occurring opioid: morphine, codeine, and thebaine. Okay. So go by the answer morphine. Rest all other drugs are synthetic opioids. Okay. Morphine is a natural drug. Which of the following drug is used for pain control in cancer patient? Remember, pethidine true, fentanyl true, methadone true, remifentanil false. Remifentanil is a very short acting drug. Okay. And among them, methadone is the longest acting drug. Fentanyl can be given as a transdermal patch. Okay. So remember, A, B and C can be given. Drugs used in smoking cessation is, so I have already told you that drug in CNS, there are three approved drug, first line drug for smoking cessation. The first is nicotine. Second is varenicline. And lastly, bupropion. So these are the three first line drug for smoking cessation. Then we have second line drug. Now second line drug you will write is clonidine and nortriptyline. So they are given in resistant cases of first line drug. And you can easily see the answer out here. The drug which is used, bupropion, true. Buspiron is false. Remember, buspiron is rather an anti-anxiety drug. It is not an anti-smoking drug. Okay. Then you will write varenicline true, nicotine true. So which is not used is buspiron is not used. A, C and D are used as an anti-smoking drug. Okay. All are the features of opioid intake except it causes constipation true, euphoria true, analgesia pain relief true. Now dilated pupil is false. It rather causes meiosis, not dilated pupil. So the answer is D. Derivative of morphine used in diarrhea is diphenoxylate. So I've already told you that opioids which are used in the treatment of diarrhea. So I'll show you that slide again. So opioid which is used in the treatment of diarrhea are loperamide, diphenoxylate, fidotozine, resicadrotil, eluxadoline and esimadoline. So try to remember the first two drugs, loperamide and diphenoxylate. Okay. Morphine is used in asthma, contraindicated. Okay. Kyphosis, no, not indication. Cor pulmonale, not. Left ventricular failure, true. I have already told you the three uses of morphine. One was pain. Second is acute MI. And third is acute left ventricular failure, not right. Cor pulmonale is right ventricular failure. In right ventricular failure, we don't give opioid, which is also known as acute pulmonary edema. So these are the three indications of using morphine. So the answer is D, acute left ventricular failure. Fomepizole is a selective antidote for, we have already discussed, methyl alcohol poisoning. So fomepizole, if you remember, it was alcohol dehydrogenase inhibitor. I have already told you. And it is a selective antidote for methanol. Methanol is also known as methyl alcohol. And ethylene glycol poisoning. So it is a selective antidote for the poisoning of methanol or ethylene glycol. Now, which of the following drug does not possess even slightest agonist action? So the question is asking which of the following is pure antagonist. Okay. So I'll show you that slide again. Pure antagonist opioids. So if you can see naloxone, naltrexone, nalmefene, naloxol and nalogixol. These are the pure antagonists. So keeping this thing in mind, you are finding the answer out here is nalmefene. Okay. So nalmefene is the true answer. Effect of morphine with least tolerance. So tolerance, remember, do not develop to which effect of morphine? I've already told you, tolerance do not develop to convulsion, constipation and constriction of pupil, which is also known as meiosis. to them there is no or least tolerance. So you can go by the answer constipation. Okay, so this is all about sedative and hypnotics, opioids also. So thank you very much.